Good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Please note that apologies have been received from Mark Griffin and Stephanie Callaghan, and I would like to welcome Colin Beattie, who is attending as a substitute for Stephanie, and I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 3 in private. Are members agreed? Great, we're all agreed. Thank you. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the SLARC's recommendations for councillors' remuneration and expenses from Angela Leach, who is the convener, Peter Argyle, who is a member of the committee, Rosie Docherty, Martin McElroy, and Laura Simpson, who are all members of the Scottish Local Authorities Remuneration Committee, otherwise known as SLARC, and I welcome witnesses to the meeting. And I would like to begin by inviting Angela to make a short opening statement.
Thank you. And good morning, everyone. We're very pleased to be here. We're aware that the committee has considered barriers to elected office on a number of occasions previously, and you're aware that SLARC was reconstituted in April of last year, following some work that COSLA had done and you yourselves. We started our work very much on the basis that we wanted to make sure that we had a strong evidence base. And my colleagues here all led different parts of that particular programme to make sure that the questions that we were asked in the remit were, we could respond to them, but we could respond to them with evidence that would be relevant, robust, and would stand up to scrutiny. The three parts of the evidence, just to give you an idea of the process that we undertook, was first of all to undertake a survey of all local authority councillors, so all 1,200 of them. We had a return rate of 64%, which was quite significant and statistically reliable. In addition to the answering questions, the elected members also provided us with a range of comments and free text, which we've also relied upon quite heavily in drawing our conclusions. And Peter and Martin really led on that part of the process with colleagues from the Improvement Service. In that respect, we took evidence from a number of different bodies. We relied on feedback from SOLIS, SOLAR, Directors of Finance, a range of public bodies, people in civic society and academia as well. We also undertook a survey of the governance arrangements that were in existence in local authorities, and Laura led on that part of the report for us as well. Again, important evidence that we've drawn upon in putting forward our conclusions. And finally, we also met with councils face-to-face. We had about 40 meetings with different councils, from covering the different bandings that there are applicable to councillors' pay, and we drew on that again in putting forward our findings. So the findings, very briefly, are that the demographic makeup of Scotland's councillors doesn't match the general population, and there's underrepresentation, particularly amongst women, young people and people with a disability. More than half of councillors who completed their survey reported spending more than 26 hours on formal council duties, but the variation was enormous, and I'm sure that we'll come on to that later on. The other findings were mainly that social media did create more casework, and this was a particular part of the remit. Two-thirds of the councillors had experienced online abuse or personal criticism. Again, that was something that we took account of in our recommendations. For councillors who were part of the administration, particularly council leaders, the role has definitely become more complex. And again, that was one of the questions that we were asked. Have over the years the roles of elected members become more complex? And we have concluded that yes, they have. In that respect, we drew on overview reports from Audit Scotland in particular, and a variety of other published reports to demonstrate just the complexity of the work that councils and therefore councillors undertake as well. So we've set out our recommendations. Those are before you in the reports that you've been given. And we're happy to take any questions. My final point is, though, that the last SLARC review was in 2010-11. And some of their recommendations, particularly on the banding, are similar to the contents of that report. None of that report was adopted. So it has been well over a decade since the issue of remuneration of this for councillors, the sphere of government has been considered. And I'll pause there.
That's super. Thanks so much for that overview, and certainly the kind of it was helpful to hear the breadth and depth of the work that you did and where you went to kind of find the evidence of the situation we face. We've got a number of areas that we wanted to explore, and I will begin on the area around councillor workload and responsibility. But before I do, I just want to declare an interest because I have a brother who is a serving councillor at the moment, so I just want to get that on the record. In terms of councillor workload and responsibilities, there's an assumption in public life that MPs, being an MP or an MSP is a full-time job, and I'd be interested to understand why a local councillor job is not considered full-time when the demands on councillors are at least on par with parliamentarians at times.
So we did look at the difference or the similarities between MPs, MSPs and elected members in councils. We are making a recommendation that the remuneration that is paid to councillors should be in recognition of the role that they undertake rather than being focused particularly on the hours that that are worked. But it is true to say that both in the survey, and Peter and Martin may want to add to this, but both in the survey, our follow-up meetings in particular, the spread of hours that councillors undertake is quite considerable. And that varies on the composition of the council, whether people are in administration, and the number of councillors in the multi-member wards. So there could be elected members who work less than 10 hours a week. There's others that are certainly doing what you would consider to be full-time hours. So the spread was quite considerable. The reason that we've not said that all councillors should be considered as full-time is that potentially that could be another barrier to elected office. As you can see from the survey, there was a considerable number, I think about 40%, that did have other work or caring responsibilities. And we felt that it was really important that in attracting people to this office, that we didn't put any further barriers in the way. So the recommendation that we're making on the amount of salary for elected members is in recognition of the role and responsibility that they undertake. And then there's obviously a higher rate for those in senior positions.
I mean, I take your point around not kind of equating the role with hours necessarily. I would like to just ask a further question. So in 2005, that was the first SLART report, and it found that councillors worked 32 hours per week on average. And the most recent report says that the average is now about 29 hours. And I'd be interested to hear what you found in terms of evidence that the workloads and responsibilities of councillors have increased over the years.
Okay. So I'll go back to the survey that we've undertaken, and while we had 64% return rate, it obviously isn't all elected members, and it is quite difficult just to pin down the exact nature of the roles elected members undertake, particularly when we think of the diversity of the 32 local authorities that we have. There has been a change in the reported hours, and this was reported from individuals themselves by way of the survey. As far as the complexity is concerned, the overview reports in particular from the Accounts Commission repeatedly from, I think it was 2018 onwards, focus on the changes that are made. We've got a breakdown of that if the committee would like that to be submitted as further evidence. But it cites, for example, the continued financial challenges that councils face and therefore the decision-making that elected members have to take. It talks about the changing policy environment. The audit reports also talk about the national policies which local authorities then have been asked to implement. The changing arrangements as far as partnerships are concerned, so a greater reliance on community planning, regional planning, and the complications or the complexity of managing health and social care over two sectors. So those were some of the issues. And on top of that, they also cite that while there's a lot more work that is moving towards being recognising the importance of a regional approach, elected members and councils really do have to focus on local priorities. So there is a balance that has to be struck between those. So those are some examples of the evidence that we've drawn upon to enable us to form the conclusion that the role has become more complex.
Yeah.
Can I just pause and ask if my colleagues, Martin in particular, would like to say anything on that one?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. So I'm not exactly certain how the 2005 figure was achieved, but for us, when we were doing our survey, we had to delineate, or we had to be very careful that when we were surveying members, councillors, to ensure a difference was recorded between formal council business and what some councillors perceived was part of their role, but actually we didn't want to include, for example, party business or other informal things that they did almost in addition. And whilst some councillors might feel like it's unfair because they think that's part of their role, actually we had to take quite a strict view of what we thought the public purse should be remunerating people for as a role. So we didn't want, we couldn't include, or we took the view that we shouldn't include anything that was party political, for example. That's not to say that political groupings on councils, that time was included and recorded. But the other point is that for some people who were reporting fewer hours, who were also working as well, it wasn't actually in the survey, but it was in the engagement sessions, they were telling us that they wanted to do more, but they couldn't because they were having to work or have other responsibilities. So, and they had to work because of the remuneration levels. So if they had the opportunity to do it full-time, I think they definitely would have, or would have done more hours, undoubtedly. But the fact that the remuneration didn't allow them to do that was identified both in the survey and in the engagement.
That's thank you for that clarification. I think that's really, really helpful to get that, and that kind of, the 2005, as you say, we don't have an understanding of how that was defined, and I think it's good to get clear on what the public purse should be funding. Mm-hmm. Just kind of trying to frame my question here. So much of what's included in the sample role outlines would have been familiar to councils 20 or 30 years ago, and I'd be interested to understand what councillors are doing now that they weren't doing. I mean, in a way, you've kind of covered this, I think, to some degree, Angela, but if there was anything else that you think that they weren't doing, but they're doing it now, and at the time of the last review in 2011. So is there anything more? I think you've touched on quite a lot of things.
I think the only other element that I would add is that over the years there's been an increased focus on the importance of improved outcomes for people in local communities. There was one stage where in councils, The priority was really the delivery of services, you know, delivery of good services, efficient services. But that has certainly morphed, I think, more into, or the committee felt, into an approach that it's important to see how poverty is being addressed, outcomes for young people in terms of employment, opportunities, economic activity in local authorities in general. So it's moved away from the provision of mainstream services to look much more holistically at what's important to improve the outcomes for people within their local areas. And then the other aspects that I've touched on, increased demand, increased financial pressures, certainly a far greater identification of need within communities than perhaps was ever there before, and a recognition that one sector can't address the complexities of need within a community, that there has to be an increased reliance on working with partners.
Yeah, and I could imagine that because we've got a greater understanding of equalities and also community empowerment, that's kind of where that kind of thing, we've kind of shifted our perspective of what we want to see Scotland become. Yeah. Okay, I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey with some questions.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning, Angela, and to your colleagues, you're really welcome. I wonder if I could just continue with that theme that Martin was talking about there, and whether you distinguished between councillors who work full time in another place, another job, and councillors who don't, and what the kind of average number of hours was for each. Because in my experience, when I was a local councillor from 1992 onwards to 2007, it was almost impossible to do the council job properly. And I recall, convener, I had 10 days a year. There was an issue about public, you know, time off for public duties was very much at the heart of that. So I'm wondering how the councillors that work full-time in a job somewhere else can possibly squeeze in 29 hours a week to do their council duties. And I wonder if you got a strong message about that particular issue, Angela, or Martin.
I will bring Martin in, but we did get a very strong indication of that as we went through the process. I think that it was very much the case that because of the level of remuneration, people felt that they had to work. Unless they had another source of income, they really had to have a job to be able to live, to support their family and the likes. I think that in particular, though, there were many sacrifices that people that worked made. They quite often cited that they were not considered for promotion, that if they went for another job, the employer wouldn't really consider, as soon as they knew that they were also a counsellor, they wouldn't be considered for the role. And it really was a real juggling act for them. So those are my initial comments, but pass on to Mark.
So absolutely. Something that we found was a very regular... So as part of the survey, we had the opportunity for folk to add their own comments, free text, and we generated about 60 pages worth of comments. And a recurring theme was, the only way I can do this is because I either have a supportive employer or I'm retired or independently wealthy. And the supportive employer was almost always a parliamentarian who had the flexibility and understanding of what the role of a councillor is, and that sometimes you do get a phone call a couple of days before a committee meeting and somebody has to disappear, or there's a public meeting at night or something like that. So parliamentarians, staffers made up, like, I think it was about five times as many people who were employed compared to people who worked in sort of other industries. So it was very heavily represented. And we had a couple of debates on the committee about the quandaries that poses, whether or not, as a local member, are you compromised? Because, for example, if your employer is a local parliamentarian who takes a different view on a local issue, does that potentially compromise you in your employment? Or can you be objective as a local representative? So it did throw up all sorts of interesting quandaries, but undoubtedly there is absolutely no way in which, and we're talking about people who are actual council leaders who couldn't do their role because of the remuneration unless they were either employed by a parliamentarian or had family who were supporting them in that. So it's not just the individual councillor, it's their families as well, which I found quite telling.
Any recommendations in that regard, especially on the time off for public duties side, or even reciprocal sabbatical salary when you become a councillor, or anything like that? Or was that out with the scope of your work?
Well, there's already a provision in, is it the 1983 Act, about it, and we were, I think we would have loved to have spent a lot more time looking at it, but we were quite constrained by time. And I know it was something that we started to explore, and before we went too far down the rabbit hole, Angela had to remind us that we had a deadline. So I think future SLAC has to definitely look at something like this, and what its recommendations would be. And also I think employers have to understand better what it is councillors do, because if you think about the change in attitude and culture in the past maybe 20 years around employing reservists in the army or and other people who have public duties, for example, I mean, a jury duty, it would be unthinkable for an employer not to let an employee away for jury duty. So why have they got such a difficult attitude around, a belligerent attitude around councillors who also perform important public functions?
And if I could just add, one of the recommendations in the report is that there should be a campaign to promote the role of councils and also the role of an elected member, the role of councillors, because we did find that those roles are not understood. Quite often they're not understood by partner organisations, and they most certainly weren't understood in a lot of the community discussions. Really understanding the role, the complexity and the importance of what councils do and elected members was one thing. And the other aspect that we've recommended was the governance review that we undertook. And there are very few local authorities that automatically review their governance arrangements at the beginning of a new term of office, so that the particular demands on time for councillors can be taken into account, and there could be some way of adjusting timetables for committee meetings or the likes. So we're recommending in the report that at the start of every new term that there is a review of governance that is undertaken to try as far as possible to accommodate the differences that there are between the parties and the work patterns or the commitments that elected members have.
Thanks very much for those really, really helpful comments. I wonder, could I ask you about multi-member wards and whether you think or you found that the impact on councillors' workload has changed because of the multi-member ward arrangement, or has it diminished? My experience, of course, is that the members find themselves even busier than they used to be because they have to be on their toes most of the time because they've got colleagues in the same wards now. But did you make any particular findings in that area, Angela?
We did. In particular through the comments that we received as part of the survey and in the face-to-face meetings, the elected members that we interviewed reported that the multi-member ward had actually added to their workload, because previously when they had fewer people in their ward, they also would have had fewer community councils, parent councils and all the community meetings that inevitably goes along with being a councillor. Now they find that they have a far bigger patch, far bigger area to cover, and that necessitated them attending more and more meetings. There were some who reported an alliance with colleagues in the ward, and they tried to split the duties where they could. But that was probably exceptional rather than the rule. Again, I'm not sure if there's anything that
Peter... I could add to that. Yeah, there's no doubt that the multi-member wards has made life more complicated, both for members and for officers, because one of the other elements that came out through the free comments was that officers, council officers, get similar comments coming from three members or four or whatever the number might be. And certainly from my own experience, I was a councillor for 23 years, covering the change from single member ward to multi-member ward. And it completely changed the dynamic, completely changed it. I'm not saying for a moment it's not the right thing to do. If we want a fair electoral system, it's the only way it'll work. But it does make it more complicated, there's no doubt about it. And one of the imponderables, one of the immeasurables, is, of course, the personal relationship between the members in a ward. And if those relationships are good, which in my experience they have been, then things can work really well. If, in my experience, has been the same there, if they're not good, then it can become very, very complicated.
Thank you for that. My last question for me, it's really about should there be any legislative requirements, for example, for our councillors in the performance of their duties to require councillors to attend formal committees and meetings of the council and so on? Because I know that's been an issue in the background for a wee while. Did you look at that issue and make any recommendations on that?
And as far as the report's concerned, we are making a recommendation that there should be some reporting of activity, perhaps not performance, because unlike health boards, for example, where there is a performance review of board members on an annual basis, it would be quite difficult to see how that a similar process could work, who would undertake such a review. And ultimately, it is the electorate that will hold elected members to account. But to allow the electorate to have an informed picture of how active that individual has been in their ward area, we did think that there was work that could be done. There is the obligation that there is attendance at two committees in a year. We did feel that there was probably more in terms of how active were individuals in attending training, committees. Were there others? But we didn't have the time to actually go into what those elements would be. We know that there's a review of the benchmarking framework that the Improvement Service operates, so it could perhaps be incorporated in there. And I think that COSLA, when we've spoken to leaders, are mindful that that would be an area that they could explore in a bit more detail. But I think in terms of transparency, it would be something that should be considered, and it's one of our recommendations.
Okay. Thanks very much for those answers to those questions. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Willie. Just picking up on the kind of tracking councillors performing their duties, I mean, also an interesting thing, because if you measure activity, somebody might not be so active, but they might be able to think well about connecting and joining dots and find a way through and a solution that might not take them as long, or they might not need to attend so many things. So it is a very difficult thing to measure, isn't it? How people show up and really support the community and find those solutions for equalities or for community empowerment or whatever it is. So quite a challenging thing to measure, really.
It is. We just didn't have the time to look at it. But there, you wouldn't expect, you know, in the health board, and we did look at how it operated in the health boards, then it's the chair that undertakes a review of each of the members that sits on that board. But given the political makeup of Scotland's councils, it wouldn't be feasible to ask a leader to do that. And that's where that added value is, where elected members bring to their office could be assessed and commented upon. So it's maybe a blunt tool, but it's about some kind of indication. Because again, going back to earlier comments, we did hear about elected members who worked tirelessly within their local area, and there were others for a variety of reasons, whether it was because they worked or they had family commitments or because of their position within the council, weren't as active as others. So that was really why we thought. But in terms of, if you know, we are going to be suggesting, or we have suggested, that there is an allowance paid, which is quite a significant increase, then we thought it reasonable to suggest that there was some monitoring of activity levels.
Yeah, that really makes sense. I'm going to introduce a new topic around pay and severance, and I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs for that. Thanks.
Convener, good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us today. The recommendations around Edinburgh and Glasgow City Council leaders being pegged at MSP salaries. I just wondered, given the responsibilities as an Edinburgh MSP, I see our leaders at most things I'm attending, so I know how busy they are. Just wondered where that had come from and whether or not you thought they should be pegged at, you know, for example, an English mayor level, and just wondered the rationale around that.
So we did a fair bit of analysis in this respect. We looked at the remuneration and expenses for MPs, MSPs in relation to elected members. And Rosie will certainly want to comment on this. I think it's fair to say that when we looked at the role of an MSP, and you know, it was the role descriptor for an MSP, and looked at the complexity of the work that a leader in Edinburgh and Glasgow, the two largest cities in the country, that it seemed that there was a comparison that could be made that would justify that level of remuneration being paid. Now, it's not an exact science. It wasn't job evaluation. We didn't break each role down to different segments. But over the piece, looking at the work that those leaders do in making sure that they lead their council effectively, that they have large populations, they have large budgets that they're managing, and the complexity of some of the issues that are faced within those large cities seemed at least commensurate with an MSP's salary. Mm-hmm. I'll pause there and ask if Rosie wants to add anything to that.
I think I would reiterate the Chair's statement that it's not an exact science and it is about judgment. We did quite a lot of research and analysis looking at the salaries of MSPs and ministers and the salaries of MPs and ministers and the relationship of the different three tiers of the democratic process in terms of number of constituents, size of remuneration, and your point about English mayors. They're not like English mayors. That's not a suitable comparator. And looking at it within the Scottish democratic process, we felt was appropriate, given the sometimes local, regional, national, international dimensions of the work of council leaders, particularly in Glasgow and Edinburgh. It seemed to us that you know, it was a justified comparison to look at the MSP role.
We did also look at board members. We spent quite a bit of time looking at how board members across public bodies are paid and remunerated. But again, there's such a variation there that we really couldn't pull any comparisons with. So, as Rosie said, it seemed appropriate to stick to the different spheres of government. And link in some way those large roles to a person in the national government.
No, that's helpful. Thank you. There was also a recommendation around severance payments to be introduced for councillors losing their seats at elections. And we already have a set of principles for MSPs in terms of terms served, up to two terms, salary, which is half taxed. And obviously, when STV first was brought in for council wards, we saw payments provided for councillors standing down. So just wondered if the witnesses could explain how you see that working and what sort of costs might be attached to that.
So on the costs, we couldn't hazard a guess at that, to be perfectly honest. And we've said that in the report, that does require further work. And I do think that COSLA have undertaken to explore that further with the Parliament. I think that time and time again, when we met with elected members, we heard that the prospect of not being re-elected and then being unemployed for a period was often a deterrent for standing for a second term. And that was particularly true of female elected members. So rather than face that, that position, quite a few reported to us that they had stood down or would be stepping down and looking for other jobs in advance of that. So that is really why in the recommendations we've said that there should be consideration of a severance scheme for elected members modelled on the one that applies in the Parliament. We only had really 9 months to pull the report together, so our time was really constrained to the remuneration and expenses element. So we haven't given the severance element as much thought as we would have liked. But I think that that's something that could be taken forward out with SLARC.
No, that's helpful. Thank you. And, you know, the principles are there, like here in the Parliament for MSPs. I also wondered in terms of the recommendation around councillor pay as a percentage of Scottish public sector average pay from 2022, why that was the chosen method instead of looking at more recent points in pay.
So it is the most recent available?
Is it right?
We did look at
that. Answers that question.
So we've taken it as far as we possibly could in terms of currency. We've chosen that particular table because, again, as we mentioned earlier, because of the enormous variation in the hours that elected members work. We've also proposed an increase of the percentage from 75% of the median to 80% of the median, reflecting what was reported in the survey in terms of hours worked and the increase up to 29 or thereabouts.
Thanks. And just finally, I had a question. I've spoken to Conservative councillors across Scotland who stood down and who are still councillors, and just wondered whether or not you looked at any points around moving towards evening meetings, for example, for flexibility for people, and also secretarial support. That's one of the things which has really surprised me. Here in Edinburgh, the council groups are very well supported, but other councils, that just isn't the case. Or it's actually used sometimes during negotiations for administration, which I think is completely wrong, but seems to take place across Scotland. So just wondered, given, again, MSPs, we're very well supported, and I don't see how we'd be able to do that this job without that. Just wondered whether or not you had done any deep dive into these areas as well.
We did on both. So the whole how the councils operate, how they organise their governance arrangements, we are suggesting that that is reviewed on a term-by-term basis. And that could then take account of what the other commitments that elected members have. Even in meetings, we've not made any particular comments because we're aware that that could also disadvantage, you know, others who have caring responsibilities. So we didn't go to that. And I think it is for councils to determine what is the most appropriate form of governance that will allow maximum participation from those that are returned at each election. We did note that there, in most councils, elected members are asked to serve on a number of charitable bodies and outside organisations. Some were quite significant, and we have made a recommendation that that should be reviewed as part of the governance arrangements, because it wasn't always clear the purpose of the participation in those particular groups. As far as the admin is concerned, the governance survey did flag that up quite considerably, and we've made a recommendation that we should actually, that is an area where investment is needed. And you're right about it being used as a bit of a, these are offered up as cuts, basically. We think that's a false economy, but if you don't mind, Convener, I'll ask Laura to comment on that.
We got fairly comprehensive information back from the councils. We got an 87% response rate, and the pattern of support was very mixed. And there's a lot of support in already, so there's fairly robust support in the way of IT support for the induction and training for members. But on members' actual support for admin clerical, it has dropped significantly. Quite often the civic head and the leader of the council would have dedicated support, but the remaining councillors wouldn't have that level of support. And sometimes you had 2 to 3 support staff covering 70 councillors. So the hours vary quite considerably. So some councils did have significant support, others didn't. And that was feedback not just in the governance survey, but also in the focus groups that was fed back to ourselves that there was concern about that. There was a lot of time spent on admin clerical work that could actually be spent on constituent duties as well. So that was a factor throughout.
Thank you. Thanks, Karina.
Thanks, Miles. I'm going to bring in Colin Beattie on another topic, which is around information gathering by SLARC. Colin.
Thank you, Vera. Morning, Angela. You know, I was a councillor for a few years myself, so obviously I had some impressions during that period. Is SLARC absolutely confident that the survey results are an accurate representation of councillors' experiences, workloads, levels of commitment and so forth?
In the absence of anything else, it is. I think the fact that we had over 700 serving elected members take time to complete a fairly extensive survey. We covered a lot of different aspects of work that elected members are asked to undertake. And they also spent even further time then, given us so much in terms of free text. Some of that is in the contained in the report. There is, you know, on top of that, we did the analysis that I've already spoken about, looking at MPs, MSPs, looking at the complexity of the job. We spoke to Solace about how they viewed the role of elected members. We spoke to the Accounts Commission. So we've taken as much evidence as we possibly can in support of the survey results that we've, you know, we got back. And I think it's probably the most comprehensive survey of elected members, certainly in Scotland, that's ever been undertaken, if not in the UK.
I think that one of the things that you've taken out are that the average hours worked for an ordinary councillor is 28 hours and 45 minutes, which is quite a lot. And if they're expected to do a full-time job as well to support the councillor's role, that's going to be very tricky to work in. At best, you maybe can do a part-time, which is limiting in itself in terms of you know, your future prospects. I mean, I believe from my own experience that councillors are underpaid, but what it should be, I don't know. Do you think it's fair to say that 28 hours and 45 minutes is really a part-time job?
So we've had to draw a conclusion on this. I have to say, the hours that have come forward are the average that are reported as far as the elected members are concerned. It isn't full time, as most people would understand it. And as I've said earlier, the variation is quite considerable. So augmenting the survey results with the conversations that we had with councils, we did hear time and time again about, and from individuals themselves, that the hours varied enormously. So some could work, some couldn't. And I think that on balance, we've had to come forward and say, right, it's a part-time, the councillor's role, if we're going to define it in such a term, could be done on a part-time basis. The roles of leaders and the senior councillors, more often than not, has to be regarded as a full-time occupation.
Do you think that the fact that councillors, ordinary councillors, have to take another job in order to top up their earnings, do you think that impacts negatively on the time and effort that they're able to put in to the councillor's job? Because obviously if they have a full-time job, that's a full-time job. And unless they have a very understanding employer, they're going to find it tough to get the time off to attend council meetings and do the training and everything that one would expect of them. So I'm just asking, does that seem an unfair pressure to put on councillors?
So, I mean, I think Martin covered that. I think going back to the remit of the committee, we were asked to look at the remuneration and whether the remuneration adequately rewarded them for the roles that they were undertaking. What we've put forward is that the current remuneration doesn't reward them for the responsibilities that they undertake at this point. And that's why we're suggesting the increase of 15%, basically on top of the sum that is payable from the 1st of April of this year. In terms of, is it fair? I think that what the committee would really look for is that there is adequate compensation that would encourage as many people in Scotland to consider these vital and important roles as possible, so that when we get to the 2027 election, we see a far broader basis of people coming forward to stand for those roles.
Andrew, you yourself said earlier about some of the pressures on councillors and on the relationships. One of the things that I got feedback on, and you know, I've been out there hunting for people to stand for councils, one of the problems is mortgages. Did you touch that at all? Because often councillors in particular are refused mortgages simply because of the unstable element in their employment. It's bad enough, you know, for MSPs and MPs who have similar uncertainties if at a slightly better salary. Did you encounter that at all with councillors? Because, you know, patching together a couple of salaries, maybe a bit for the council and a bit for private work, isn't really giving the cover needed to be able to buy your own home. And these things have been a negative impact on people stepping up.
I'll bring Peter in if that's okay, but I think on that, I think it's probably the fixed term nature of the role that is the biggest barrier. At least over that term of office, there is a guarantee of that level of remuneration. But again, I go back to the severance point that at the end of that period, if you choose to stand again and you're not re-elected, then you potentially are unemployed, and I'm sure mortgage providers would take that into account. But Peter?
That issue was raised when we had discussions with the political party councillor associations. I spoke at length to most of them. There was one that I wasn't able to get in touch with, but the rest were very helpful, and that was certainly a point that was raised. Because the challenge that all parties have is finding candidates. It is incredibly difficult to find people who are willing to stand in an election. And it, I know from, again, from my own experience, the absolute last-minute nature it sometimes is of dragging somebody kicking and screaming up, oh, you're just a paper candidate, you won't get in. All of that, we've all experienced it, I know. And that was very much part of the response I had from the political parties on that. And it certainly does tie back to the cliff edge that happens if you stand and, for a second term and don't get re-elected. It is absolutely brutal, and something that I'm very, very firmly of the view needs to be addressed.
The other thing is, you're obviously collecting a lot of information, and in your paper you touched on about social media and, you know, the speed now of communications and the desire of constituents and so on to get an immediate response. Everything's immediate. I mean, I get more than 500 emails a day, so how immediate I can be, I don't know. But councillors must be encountering the same thing. What was specifically your impression here? Because it seems to me that the workload from that point of view has increased hugely in terms of the volumes and the immediacy of things that are coming forward now.
Yeah, and that certainly was what we found both in the survey and in the engagement sessions, that councillors reported a desire from the electorate to have immediate responses to queries. Social media was used fairly frequently to report on issues, so complaints or faults in housing and roads and things like that. There was an expectation that the councillor then would immediately respond, and it ties in with the support that is the admin support that is provided or not provided to elected members, and how quickly they could actually deal with that. But certainly the elected members that we spoke to did actually report that they could get queries at night and another query immediately after that, or an hour or so afterwards, to say, did you get my note? Did you get my message on X or on whatever platform it is, to be able to respond to it.
Just to touch on something else, did you actually speak to former councillors as part of this process? You know, sort of, if you like, an exit consultation with them to understand the reasons that they stood down, because it'd be quite important to know if it was salary, if it was just the uncertainties of the job, you know, or indeed online abuse, which is at the moment fairly out of control.
We spoke to some MPs and MSPs who had previously been councillors and were able to gain an insight from that perspective. And they did talk about the, really interestingly, the view from that group of individuals was that councillors, by and large, are really well known in their local area. They're seen to be available. They're seen to be people that you can contact. And that actually did mean that people reached out to them more frequently than they had possibly experienced as an MP or an MSP. So that was one of their observations. I know that COSLA did some work previously on people who didn't stand again for election. And again, there were a number of females that reported that they had stood down because of the workload, as well as the some of the comments, the adverse comments that they receive on social media. But we didn't go out and try and discuss it with a cohort of councillors. We thought about it, but it was quite difficult for us to actually gain access to people like that. But Martin?
Yeah, so part of the issue was actually identifying and contacting former councillors, because there's no kind of formal data set, or so we were kind of relying on individuals' contacts and commenting on that basis. And one of the most useful routes for speaking to former elected members was the Barriers to Elected Office group, which COSLA have been convening for a while now, who offered some really good insights, particularly to reasons why younger women were standing down, or only standing for one term and then choosing to stand down. But one of our recommendations is to have a national data set of councils, so we can actually see what the picture is nationally of the makeup. The demography.
Such a data set would be useful. However, it doesn't exist at the moment. Mm. Would the easiest thing have been not to go to the individual political parties who would have known who their ex-councillors are and who could have put you in touch?
Well, I think there was an attempt at some of that. However, there was a lot of difficulty getting individuals to engage with that. So where we did rely on personal contacts and individuals that we knew and we could identify and we did speak to incorporate their, or to seek their views, we did it where possible. In terms of a kind of a more technical scientific approach for speaking to former councillors, we didn't really have the means to do it, unfortunately, but I think it would have been really useful if we could have. And I definitely would like to have spoken to more former colleagues, as to why they stood down, because everybody will have their own individual reasons, but there will be emerging themes there, undoubtedly.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a huge loss not having that data, because that would have been really valuable to understand the reasons behind the stepping down. People step down for a variety of reasons, as you touched on. And it's unclear whether salaries as such would have been the major issue in that.
What was reported in the survey was people who, even though they were only 1 year into the term, who were considering standing down, identified the salary as an issue. So we already have the next cohort of people who will be standing down who responded to the survey. So I suspect it would be a very similar response, but salary was undoubtedly one of the factors, or the remuneration was one of the factors for people who were already identifying 1 year into their term that they would not be re-standing.
I find that a little bit extraordinary, because if you're standing for office, you know what your salary is going to be if you win.
Yeah.
And a year later, you're stepping down because it's not enough. It sounds odd.
So what we found was, and political parties were quite guilty of this, but candidates stood maybe not really fully understanding what the role entailed, and they might have had situations where their employer appeared supportive, or they thought they could have done it, but they thought they could do the role. But actually, once you're in the role, you realise perhaps it's not as straightforward as clocking off after 8 hours a day. It's full on. You do get bombarded on social media, or when you're getting your messages in the supermarket. And the other thing is, people's circumstances over the course of 5 years do change. Folk get married, have children, try to get mortgages, and they find that actually being an elected member is not, you can't do the two with your private or personal life with being an elected member. So I think it all stems from the variety of reasons why folks stand down. And actually, you're locking yourself into a 5-year contract kind of thing, where who knows what's going to happen in 4 years' time. So the folk who were indicating that they were looking to, or they were considering not re-standing, because that was asked, that remuneration was identified as one of the factors, and it was, and I suspect it would have been because they didn't fully understand what they were signing up to. The political parties, part of that press gang and folk into standing. One of our recommendations is that COSLA and the political parties have a much better process to make potential candidates understand what the role is before going for elected office. Undoubtedly, the pressure which the responses received, I think, would probably be reflective of what former councillors, the reasons they would have given, and the same themes, I think, would have emerged as well.
Did you find particular issue?
Sorry. I'm going to have to ask you to wind up because we're quite tight on time with our next panel, but I think it's been a very interesting piece of deep questioning there, and I do think there's a kind of question I have around the social media and boundaries and possibly training for councillors to understand that they don't need to be available 24/7, because that sounds really inappropriate that people are contacting them late at night and people and councillors feel that they have to respond to that. So maybe there's something there that we need to look at, and certainly we'll take note of that need for that formal data set that could be really useful for us. I think there's quite a lot of strands of work I can see that you have identified. I'm going to bring in, on the same theme, Pam Gosal.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel, and thank you so much for obviously giving us your opening statements and letting us know about all the work you've done. Obviously, councillors are out and about in their local areas and are often recognised by the public for the work they do. So I wanted to ask if the Remuneration Committee examined any views of the public on the value they get from their local councillors and what public opinion they have on council pay issues.
So that wasn't something that we did, and similar to Colin Beattie's question, I think that just to point out that there were six of us on this on a very part-time basis, so we had 6 days allocated a month. We would love to have gone into a lot more detail on this, but no, what we've drawn on is the feedback from the published report in terms of what people's view in general is of the proposed changes to bandings, to remuneration. And I can say that on social media and any comments in the press, it's been largely positive. And yes, there have been the odd one that has been critical, but over the piece, I think it's been largely positive.
Oh, thank you for that, Angela. But it's so important to understand because we do serve the public, whether we're an MSP, MP or councillor, and it's in their hands to say whether we do a good enough job or we actually add value to the local area on the work we deliver. So I think there's something to look at there. Maybe to look at the asking a public opinion through, I don't know if councils do it or something that could be recommended in the future.
terms of the activity that we talk about, some of these proposals that could be picked up. But to be honest, that was out with our remit, and given the time constraint that we had, it wasn't something that we could spend any time on, really.
Yeah, just very quickly, we did spend a little bit of time looking at the published data on public opinion of councillors in a range of other occupations. And I confess I was quite surprised at how highly councillors score. They came well up the food chain, if you like. I don't have the figures immediately to mind, but we did look at the published data relevant to Scotland on public opinion of councillors, and they scored very highly.
Shall I ask my next question? Yeah. Thank you. My next question is around benchmarking, obviously looking at comparisons in the United Kingdom and across Europe. Is there any sort of benchmarking you've done part of this report for the SLARC review, and how do other countries calculate the pay for their local politicians? Yeah.
So we did do a fair bit of benchmarking. We haven't included international comparisons in the report, but we did look at international governance structures and how they then remunerated their elected representatives. It varied enormously. And of course, the structures in different parts of Europe in particular are really, really different. We also worked with the Local Government Information Unit to look at and draw on evidence that they had gathered on how this works in different countries. We looked at Northern Ireland, we looked at Wales, and we did look at closer to home in England. Because our structure, the way that it operates with unitary local authorities in Scotland, it was really quite difficult to draw comparisons. And that's why, as Rosie said earlier, we've stuck to Scotland, and then the spheres of government that operate within Scotland seem to be the closest and most appropriate way of assessing the relative remuneration levels that should be paid.
Obviously, doing comparisons is something, but did you get any good practice from any of the authorities and the work that obviously England or under the United Kingdom has done?
I think it's difficult to say. I know that subsequent to the report being published, both Northern Ireland and Wales have contacted me and interviewed me on the contents of the report, and they feel that there's a lot that they can learn from what we've done. So I can't think of anything that immediately springs to mind elsewhere, but others seem to be looking at some of the recommendations that SLARC has made in Scotland.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks. Well, congratulations on that acknowledgement. That's great. Given that you had, you were saying earlier, the challenge around the time and the limitations, but you've certainly gathered great information. I'd like to bring in, we're going to go into a new theme around understanding barriers to local elected office. I'm going to bring in Gordon MacDonald. And Gordon, if you could just make your declaration of interest, that would be great.
Thanks very much, Convener, and a good morning, panel. And just to declare that my wife is a local government councillor and is also a council group leader. As the convener has said, I wanted to ask you about some of the barriers to local elected office. And some of my colleagues already touched upon this. Looking at your recommendations, recommendation 15 says strengthen requirements on councillors to perform their duties. 16 says to assure themselves that councillors are able to fulfil their statutory duties, and 22 says provide a minimum level of member support services. Certainly, in my experience, the local authority that my wife has been an elected councillor since 2007, they have one support worker for more than five councillors. And I'm just wondering if you had any thoughts on what the minimum level of member support for councillors should be, in particular opposition councillors, and what that should include.
So, thank you for that. We've steered away from being prescriptive in terms of what support is needed. But we have made it quite clear in the report, and certainly when we've spoken to both COSLA leaders and the special interest group in COSLA, we have stressed the importance of having adequate support for elected members. We've used the term that it's a false economy to see this area reduced, because it just restricts how local elected members can really fulfil their duties. So we're really urging councils to reconsider this. What we did hear from councillors, though, themselves, was that this was a really difficult area, because finances are so stretched in local government that the last thing that they want to be seen to be doing is enhancing an area that has given them support. And there's a bit of fear for ridicule or criticism from other political parties, and indeed ridicule from the electorate. So this was something that we did explore with elected members, and I think that a national COSLA actually making a statement about the importance of giving councillors adequate support to enable them to fulfil their duties adequately is going to be really important in the future. And we recognise that finances are really, really difficult. But without that support, it does mean that it puts a bigger strain, it's a bigger challenge for local elected members to do their work.
And you're absolutely correct, but I mean, many of our councils, the situation is politicised and polarised, and therefore should there be some kind of appeal mechanism where opposition members maybe feel that they're not getting the required support that, say, is happening in other council areas? Should there be some form of appeal mechanism, and any thoughts on who would look after that, local government ombudsman, somebody like that?
Again, I think the choices that local elected members make and councils make is really up to them. I think that we, together with COSLA, would be really keen to demonstrate the value that could be added to the role of elected members by having adequate provision and all sorts of different support. And almost that a consensus, a view that it has to be depoliticised and taken out of that contentious debate, because, you know, what value do we put on good governance at a local level?
Is there any evidence to highlight that, you know, the polarisation of politics has put people off becoming local councillors?
I think that was certainly something that came through in our engagement sessions, that the level of debate in the chamber at times could be quite critical of individuals, and that was something that led to people telling us anyway that they wouldn't be standing again for elected office when their term of office was up. I'm not sure if anybody else wants to add to that. But yes, I mean, I think that time and time again, and it was particularly, not exclusively, but there were more women that commented on the verbal attacks, the verbal feedback, criticism that they often received from both colleagues as well as the electorate.
So, and final question on this section, then I've got a couple other follow-ups. Your recommendation 21 in relation to underrepresented population groups, you've said that underrepresented groups should consider how best to enhance support for councillors. How would you go about that?
Well, I'm afraid that our term is finished at the end of this week, so we're now handing this over to other trusted parties to take it forward. And I think that there's a lot that, you know, yourselves in government as well as COSLA will be able to take forward. I think Martin talked a wee bit about the data set when Colin asked his question. We do not know, we don't have a definitive data set that tells us the makeup of Scotland's councillors. Therefore, you cannot target adequate interventions when you don't know exactly what's happening. So I can't stress enough the importance of setting something like that up so that on an ongoing basis, intervention measures can be, you know, targeted most appropriately. But more importantly, we can see trends changing over a period of time, we would hope.
Okay, so I wasn't going to ask any questions in relation to the to pay and remuneration, but I've got a couple of points that I, following the discussions we've had this morning, that I'm just looking for clarification on. So many councillors, particular administrative councillors, get paid responsibility allowances, and they also get fees from external organisations like health boards. Was there any thoughts on the continuance of that?
We're conscious that it's mainly health boards, particularly the councillors who sit on the IGBs that would then or sit on the health boards that would have a remuneration. Again, that's really up to councils to decide. But what we did note when we met councils was that very frequently when a member was paid the allowance for sitting on the health board, they didn't get the special responsibility allowance, they didn't get the senior councillor's allowance. That was then a pot of money that was used to give to somebody else, basically. So they used it, there was a lot of, you know, they used it judiciously to make sure that they had adequate provision and capacity at a senior level across the council. But no, that would be something that councils would have to take into account.
Right, OK, I'll just leave it at that. Thanks very much, Convener.
OK, thanks, Gordon. I'm just going to pick up another question around the barriers piece. And I think we've kind of touched on it earlier in the session, but I'd be interested to understand a bit more detail around the evidence that you found around pay being a significant barrier to potential candidates, particularly women, people with disabilities, lone parents and young people.
But I think that really would have come through the survey in particular and then the engagement sessions. So young people, some of the comments that we received as far as that cohort were that they had stood for office, they'd been successful in being elected and then had to negotiate with their employer time off. In one particular case, the individual did demonstrate to us how it had impacted on their job prospects, how they were no longer considered suitable for promotion for jobs at a higher level. As far as women were concerned, some of the examples that we heard from female councillors was that the remuneration combined with the antisocial hours that they then had to work meant that there was a real drain on the resource in finding childcare. So they had to look for childcare, paid childcare quite often, evenings and weekends. Now, that's not particular to women, but it was women that reported it to us more often than not. So I think that by the increase that we've suggested, it would allow some flexibility in terms of compensating for some of these expenses.
OK. Thanks very much. Do you want a brief, very brief supplementary? Yep.
Thank you, Convener. Obviously, you've touched on women and lone parents and people that are disabled. But can I ask a question? Did you, in your findings, find anybody from any other backgrounds, like BAME backgrounds, that were there any barriers there? Because obviously there's lots of cultural barriers, especially when they have to go back into the home to look after the children, to look after sometimes extended family as well, and then have a job and do council work. So it may happen, obviously, to other people as well, but I'm just asking that question.
It was interesting. We thought that we might, but when the survey results came back, it actually showed that the BAME representation amongst councillors was broadly in line with the demographic profile of Scotland. Okay. So, but it was...
Well, thank you.
It was something that was a bit of a surprise to us as well.
That's good news. And I mean, I guess it also points back to what you are really underscoring here today around the data set that tells us the makeup of Scotland's councillors, and then we can really kind of build upon that. I've got a final question, which I think you also kind of touched on a little bit, but it is really around next steps. And so recommendations of the last SLART review was published in March 2011, and they were largely rejected by the then Finance Secretary, John Swinney, MSP. And I'd be interested to get your sense of how confident you
are around the recommendations of this 2024 review being accepted?
I think that there are a lot of recommendations that really COSLA in particular can take forward, and I know that are really supportive of much of the recommendations that we've produced. I think that it's really difficult for us to comment on the you know, where this is likely to go. We know that the government hasn't produced its findings as yet, which we thought that, you know, during our time we would have been able then to comment further on and provide more evidence and information if that was possible. I think that we would just urge the government in particular to give serious consideration to what we've put forward. As I said at the beginning, we've based it on a lot of evidence. We've really, really gone out to pull as much together as we possibly can so that it is a robust report. We've also tried to be pragmatic in our suggestions. And I think that the proposal that we're putting forward that basically amounts to an annual increase of about 5 million, when you think that that is 0.04% of the Scottish local government budget, it's not a sizeable increase by any stretch of the imagination. So we think for all of those reasons that the recommendations are can be implemented, and there's still work to be done, particularly on the severance arrangements and on the data set that we've recommended.
Thank you very much. I think it's been a very useful session. And thank you all of you for the work and diligence and the robustness of this report. I think it's really, really helpful, a next step. And hopefully we did ask the Scottish Government to come to join us this morning. They weren't able to, but hopefully we will be able to get them. But the next panel will be with COSLA, so it'll be interesting to see what they have to say. So thanks so much for joining us this morning. And I now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a change of our witnesses.
And I'd like to now welcome our second panel of witnesses to the meeting. We're joined online by Councillor Shona Morrison, who is the President of COSLA, Councillor Stephen Heddle, the Vice President, and Brianna Fletcher, who is the Policy Officer for Human Rights and Equalities at COSLA. And I welcome you all to the meeting. It's good to see you all this morning. And I'd like to begin by inviting Councillor Morrison to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you. Lovely to see everybody this morning. And sorry we're not there in person, but you'll appreciate that we have some distance to travel and busy diaries. So really heartening to hear the discussion that went on previously, and great to hear lots of lived experience from committee members, whether it's personally or through family. So thanks very much for having myself and Councillor Heddle here today. I want to thank Angela and the committee on behalf of COSLA leaders for the job that they've done. The consultation and engagement has been thorough and far-reaching. I'd like to say how pleased I am to join the session to discuss what I think is one of the key issues of current times for local democracy. Fundamental to good, informed and inclusive decision making is a healthy system of local democracy, and we need to eliminate any barriers which get in the way of people's desire to make a difference through engagement in local politics and the democratic process. Councillors manage huge budgets, shape our infrastructure and oversee essential services like healthcare and education. These decisions have a profound impact on our daily lives. You will no doubt be aware of the programme of work COSLA is doing through our Barriers to Elected Office Special Interest Group. This includes councillor safety, tackling barriers to candidacy, councillor safety and working culture in council, female councillors and gender balance and support for councillors. And most importantly, terms and conditions for councillors, which of course includes remuneration. A realistic level of remuneration is an important practical factor in attracting and retaining prospective candidates to the role of councillor, and is one of the starting points for a reinvigoration for local democracy. I'd like to make one important observation before the committee get into the detail of the report, and it's one that Angela has made, and it's the fact that, to my understanding, none of the recommendations from the last LARC report, which was published in 2011, were implemented. So I am keen that, despite the budgetary pressures, which we're all very aware of, we secure a positive joint commitment to implementing the recommendations set out in the report, all of which are supported by COSLA leaders. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks very much, Shona, for that. We're going to turn to questions. I just want to let you know that we will operate your mics. And I think, Shona, what we'll do is we'll direct our questions to you. And then just if you want to bring in Stephen Heddle or Brianna, I think that's the simplest way to go about it. OK, so I've got a couple of questions to get us going. So I'd be interested to hear what COSLA's views are on the role profiles and the workload calculations included in the SLARC report, and if you have a thoughts around the change of the role of the council that came up in the previous session, kind of like the more complex aspects of it over the last 10 years.
Thanks, Chair. Just keen to say from the outset that, of course, leaders are supportive in whole of all the recommendations from the committee. And we've had a good, thorough discussion at many sessions, which Angela and the committee have been part of as well, which has been really appreciated and helpful. So, yes, absolutely support the fact that the role has become much more complex over recent years. So we found that a massive increase in online working, that has been reflected in the SLARC reports, certainly during the pandemic, when we all made that shift to working online. It obviously became a way that was helpful for us to establish communication, and we've continued on that working process in a lot of councils. So again, another area that we've focused on to reduce barriers. Certainly myself, living in a rural and remote authority, Stephen will be the same. It makes accessing meetings like this far better, but it also lends itself to creating busier days. So we find find ourselves rolling from one meeting online to the other. So that certainly has increased, I would say, meetings and obligations. I think the complexity of the areas we work in present day society have increased. And certainly when you look at systems like integration, health and social care, and working with our partners, that absolutely has offered a different element for the working life of a counsellor. We have, complex caseworkers, as you'll appreciate, as MSPs, often with very little admin support, which again was touched on in the last session. Majority of councils don't have the likes of caseworker to rely on, and we tend to do all of our own admin and casework. We don't have opportunity to do proxy votes, so that's an area we're looking into at the moment through COSLA. But again, creates somewhat of a barrier when it comes to councillors being able to attend or not sessions. And we have complexity around access and issues around family care, childcare for meetings that often run into the evening. Some of our councils work, councils meet rather in the evenings, as well as our community responsibilities. So on a whole, yes, it feels much more intense, certainly even since I came into post in 2017, and I'm sure it looks very different from decades gone by. But I'll maybe ask Stephen if he'd like to comment any further.
Yeah, thanks very much, Shona. I'd like to join you in complimenting the SLAC committee and the report. It's a very thorough report, and I think the findings in it are well-found. And it enjoys the confidence of council leaders as well, who have endorsed the report in full. I mean, there is a view being expressed that perhaps it doesn't go far enough, but it's certainly a step in the right direction. And the historical context of the 2011 report not being adopted means I think there's a degree of urgency in the Scottish Government considering this and responding positively to it. I suppose if there's a disappointment, it's perhaps that the, and this is not the fault of the SLAC committee in any manner of means, it's the hope was that they could have reported in time for the 2024 25 budget cycle, and any resourcing requirements could have been addressed then. And indeed, we are actively seeking for the findings to at least be backdated to April this year. But I think the point is that it's not just a matter of months late, it's probably about 13 years late in actually taking the remuneration consideration forward and bring it up to date. You're asking about the workload and how it's changed. I think, in addition to what Shona was saying, there is a constant scrutiny, more so than ever before, through the very many social media channels that we participate in and have to respond to, or perhaps because of the pressures that come across them, don't participate in. And, that's perhaps to the detriment of our availability. I think there's also the context of difficulty. I mean, in terms of the new issues, the report goes into that. It speaks about the IGBs, it speaks about city deals and regional growth deals and the element of that. And it makes the point very well about the fact that a councillor's job isn't something where you're measured by the checks on your timesheet. There's also a lot of responsibility associated with that, and that has to be recognised as well. But when I say difficulty, I mean, of course, the fact that we're operating in a constrained financial context and the decisions we make have to be so much harder. And the decisions we make inevitably lead to additional casework for the councillor. And in terms of the kind of expectations around the role, I think, as the report notes, new members coming in constantly, consistently report that the job is more onerous and more time-consuming than expected.
Mm. Okay, just I'm just going to pick up on... I've got another question. I think, Shona, having said I'd come to you, I'm just going to pick up this question with Stephen because it's right on what he's talking about, which is that SLARC have stated that the role of the councillor should be continue to be fulfilled on a part-time basis. But it sounds from what you're saying, Stephen, and actually, Shona, what you said as well previously, that, you know, really is that the appropriate description for the role?
I would agree that they were generally uncomfortable at the description of part-time, and I think the committee themselves make the important point of not referring to ordinary councillors, referring to councillors in a correct attempt to, you know, not diminish the role of the elected member. The fuller part-time element, I think the previous evidence session has gone into the fact that you need to consider a couple of things really here. A lot of people will report that they're doing the role part-time. I mean, it's an element of the self-fulfilling prophecy around it. Because if the remuneration for the role isn't enough for a full-time job, and you have commitments in terms of mortgage payments and supporting your family, you're going to need to seek additional employment. And, you know, this is an issue particularly for younger elected members, and it's a demographic which we're very much seeking to attract. So the remuneration itself is driving people into viewing the job as a part-time job. But there's the Angela made the point very well, but resisting calling it a full-time job because this could in itself be a barrier to elected office. I think some people will come into the job as professionals and wish to retain a currency in their field as professionals, to recognise that they may wish to pursue a life after the council. Because if you come in with a professional skill and you dedicate yourself full-time to the council, you're going to lose your currency, and you're going to find it difficult to return to your field and find work afterwards. Mm-hmm. So I think there's two sides to that coin.
Okay, super. Shona.
Thanks, Chair. Yeah, just on that point, I think that's a really important thing that Stephen raises there around maintaining those roles for many of our councillors, because that brings huge value into our councils, because it's very much lived experience that people bring with them. So there is that element to it as well. It was just a few other points that I wanted to make on the initial question. So and very much not an issue for a Scottish Government, but we did find myself and our Chief Executive and Stephen have been visiting all 32 of our authorities over the last 6 to 7 months. I think we're just over halfway there. And certainly issues around population growth or the alternative and depopulation. But certainly that's been a huge amount of pressure on for some of our smaller councils like likes of Midlothian, who currently have 18 elected members for quite a sizable population. So again, that's an issue that we want to bring to the Boundary Commission, but putting huge pressure on small amounts of councillors to cope with the casework that brings, and certainly the authorities like that, the authorities like Stephen and myself, you know, we have no anonymity. So when it comes to part-time, well, I would argue that it's 24 hours a day for a councillor. You're very, very visible in your community, as you'll all appreciate as MSPs, and whether that's popping into the shops or whatever, there's always somebody wanting to catch you. It's really hard to define part-time, because obviously weekends are taken up with community events, evenings are taken up with community events, but there's also the benefits to that. I like the flexibility of my job. I like being able to a certain extent, organise my own day, and appreciate in the last session the point being made by yourself, Chair, about those long hours and boundaries. But equally, lots of councillors find it quite helpful to pop on the end of their emails that they don't work usual hours, that they may respond to something in the early hours of the morning, but there's no there's no expectation for people to reply to that, obviously. But again, that works in often with family caring responsibilities, other jobs. So it has its positives and its negatives.
Thanks very much for that, Shona. Maybe there's something about the general public understanding that kind of, that is a unique setup, and each councillor will be managing their time in different ways, potentially.
Yeah.
I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey with a number of questions.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to our COSLA colleagues online. I wanted to ask your view on an issue I should really have asked Slark about before, but the huge disparity between the salaries that senior council officials receive compared to the senior elected members. There's quite a distance between the two, and we know there's different reasons for that and different scales and so on and so forth. But is that an issue that has come up in conversation amongst the local elected members over the years, particularly when you think about the responsibilities that the senior elected members carry, when sometimes the officials that are under their direction can often be earning three times as much as they are? Is that an issue that has cropped up in conversation at all over recent years?
I couldn't possibly comment on that, Mr. Coffey. I'm here to advocate on behalf of elected members. It's not something that we've experienced during our visits, certainly, to half the councils in Scotland. So, no, it's not something that has been brought up with myself, I have to say. But, my focus is absolutely to advocate on behalf of our remuneration for our elected members.
Steve, any semblance of a discussion about that in your experience?
Not really. I mean, there might be some wry observations and a clear recognition that our officer colleagues have much nicer suits and shoes than we do. it's not really a kind of source of envy. I mean, we recognise the kind of the context that we operate in. But the kind of fundamental point is, I suppose, not that councillors are seeking to be paid the same as the officers, but we're seeking to be paid a bit more to allow a wider representation of the public to see being a councillor as an attractive job and one that they can sustain on a longer-term basis.
Very diplomatically answered. Thanks very much for that. I wonder then if I could ask you about the different banding arrangements that we see in Scotland. And for example, if you're in Glasgow or Edinburgh, we could potentially see the council leaders in those authorities potentially earning up to £20,000 more than councillor leaders in other authorities. And From my experience as a local councillor for many years, there's the same amount of hours in every day and every week, and I certainly know councillor leaders and civic heads who spend all of their time on their civic duties, and that's from the small authority to a bigger authority. So why do you think that difference should be there and is justified to be there, would you say?
Thanks, Mr. Coffey. I think Angela phrased it well. These larger councils, Edinburgh, Glasgow, they have their very own unique complexities, and we all appreciate how hard the group of councillors work in both of our larger cities. It would be remiss of me not to say that that's not been challenged by some of our members in smaller authorities. You'll appreciate, and you've very eloquently phrased it there, the difficulties and challenges that remote and rural authorities face every day, and councillors even just getting to work can take several hours. Highland Council, when you have a huge geographic spread, you're talking 3 to 4 hours for a lot of these councillors to even get into Inverness to sit in committee. So albeit made easier with the teams being more readily available and online working, but yeah, absolutely, it's although we have the cities have larger populations. Certainly issues, like I mentioned before, about, you know, there's no anonymity at all in these small communities. So vast amounts of casework just from going about your sort of daily business. So I think on balance, I think leaders absolutely recognise the difference between the bandings, but not to say that they wouldn't argue those who are in a lower banding, that they are just as busy as leaders in our bigger authorities. Stephen, I had something.
Thanks for that, Shona. Steve, have you got a view on that? And particularly the recommendation to replace the four bands with three bands, I think, and move the first band into the second band, if you understand my meaning there. What's Cosla's view about that banding arrangement, and do you support that move to have three bands?
We do support it. I mean, as Shona has said, there's certainly been representations from some of our members as to why still have three bands? You know, why not just have a band that represents the fact that all councillors effectively have the same legal responsibilities and the same breadth of ambition to deliver for our citizens. And, you know, there's a lot of merit in that argument. But certainly the recommendations are a step in the right direction. Because certainly the lowest band, which is populated by very few councils, one of which was my own, and, you know, I've been a council leader here, and felt that the remuneration that I was receiving when I was consistently working 60 hours a week running a local authority, that has all the range of issues that any mainland authority would have, but also operates 7 airfields, operates a complex harbour, including an oil port and a 24/7 marine towage and pilotage operation. You know, it seemed anomalous that we were being paid less rather than being paid more. As has been mentioned, there is a view that the three bands is maybe still too many bands, but certainly it's a significant improvement on the situation of four. So, you know, collectively we support the recommendation to SLAC.
Okay, thanks for that, Steve. So a step in the right direction from your own point of view. Many thanks for those answers. Thank you, Convener.
Ms. Willey, I'm now going to bring in Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. Perhaps, Sean, I can ask you a question about, if the Scottish Government accepts the recommendations of the SLARC review, what changes in legislation would be required to put it in place?
The main one, I think, Colin, that would come to mind would be around severance. Apart from that, I'm not entirely sure. I might ask Brianna quickly if she could come in on that point.
Brianna, are you there?
We're just waiting for our microphone to be attached to you, Brianna.
There we go. Thank you very much. I'm not going to comment on the legislative elements because I think that is the Scottish Government to determine, and I understand that the advice to the Minister, there was some complexities. They were still working out on what required legislation, but I do understand that it's largely the severance payment, but also the uplift would have a legislative element as well. But there are a few bits that are still being worked out, and I've not been privy to that advice to the Minister.
I mean, it seems to me that there could be a bit of legislation involved in this. I'm not an expert on what bit has to come forward for legislation and not, and some can just be done by agreement with the Scottish Government. How easy do you think this implementation is going to be? Shona, it doesn't seem that complicated to me if agreement is reached between, for example, the Scottish Government and Cosla. Am I being too simplistic?
I hope not, Colin, because we would like to see, obviously, you know, there's been a delay for one and another reason over the last few months on us even getting to this position. And again, you know, we would have originally the minister would have joined us today, but with changes, obviously, that will happen later in the year. So we're really keen for this to move at pace. It won't surprise you that during our visits to each authority that we're having significant questioning and pressure from our councillors who are very invested in the report about where we are in the process. So I really hope not. I would really like to think that we can move at pace in the coming months to make sure that those councillors who stood for election 2022 with the belief that we would have been looking a hard look at having a hard look and the Scottish Government would be investing you know, an independent board to look at our remuneration, would in fact bring about some change in the coming months.
Can I ask you just about perhaps a more controversial recommendation from SLARC, which is, would COSLET agree with the recommendation to strengthen legislation to ensure councillors perform their duties?
So that absolutely is a question I think the government will have. But when, with regards to, I appreciate Angela has a comment earlier on about having that sort of that data available. So I appreciate it. I'm also in another role, chair of the Improvement Service. So the benchmarking will really help with that comment I made earlier around not all councils having the likes of caseworker. Obviously, caseworker gives you some really rich data when it comes to the work that councillors are doing. So at the moment we have a situation where councillors have to attend, I think it is one full council every six months, and to many councillors that wouldn't feel acceptable. But it's also around, you know, when councillors are there, the value they bring to meetings and their work within their communities. So it's fairly complex and difficult to pin down, I think would be my answer.
Certainly from the previous witnesses that we talked to, there was a broad variety of issues that impact on councillors and how much time they can actually allocate to the job. Mention was made of the 28 hours and 45 minutes, which is the average that an ordinary councillor spends in the job. I'm not sure that sounds like part-time.
It doesn't feel like part-time, Colin, at all. I think those, if it is 20 hours, they're incredibly intensive. And like I say, it's all the less visible elements to the role. So the preparation for ones takes up a massive amount of time, and everybody around the table will appreciate how much reading as elected members we have to do. So the preparation, the research, which most of us do ourselves, we don't have any support for that. Press releases we do ourselves in the majority, and we don't have, apart from, you know, official press that goes out from the council, and we don't tend to have that. So there's lots of those less visible elements to the job that are really difficult to record. Like I say, the bumping into somebody in the co-op, I live next door to a co-op, I never come back into my house, it's usually about 20 minutes if I go for a pint of milk. You're picking up casework all the time. It's just making sure that you're visible, that you're attending. Again, you know, we as councillors will attend coffee mornings, sales, school events, etc. They all come with a cost. You're there and you're spending money. So it's all those types of areas that we don't that we probably don't record, that we just, as part of, you know, at the end of the day, most councillors are sort of grassroots activists in one way or another within their communities. So often, probably we're not very good at recording that as our official responsibilities. It's just what we do.
Just coming back to the original question, are you actually aware of any evidence that councillors are not performing their duties?
I'm not. No, that would be up to each authority to highlight if there's any issue with individual members.
Thank you, Convener.
I'm now going to move on to questions from Miles Briggs.
Convener, good morning.
to the panel, online panel. Nice to see you again. I wanted to ask a couple of questions with regard in relation to costs and then also some of the barriers to elected office. And given the ongoing issues we're seeing and unions currently balloting their members for pay-related strike action, just wondered how you believe a 40% pay rise for councillors would be received by the wider local government workforce.
Yeah, thanks. Morning, Miles. Really nice to see you again. I think it's a difficult one. There's no getting away from that. We all appreciate the severe constraints that we have in local government at the moment. And the last thing we want to do is be cutting services and then, you know, be pitted against an increase in remuneration with the priorities of our local authorities. And you know, our absolute direction and clear ask from leaders is that this is funded by Scottish Government. So, yeah, incredibly difficult. Absolutely appreciate the sensitivity around it. Angela spoke about communicating the role of the councillor to our communities and the importance of the role. So a huge bit of work for us and Scottish Government. You know, I mentioned in my opening comments that whatever we have to do, it must be hand in hand, it must be in partnership. Whatever recommendations are agreed upon, we must ensure that that message is coming from both Scottish Government and from ourselves about the value of the councillor and the role that we play. That is incredibly important and the crux. When we spoke about barriers, often, certainly in the barriers to elected office working group, when we've spoken to councillors, it's that value that, you know, that's not put on the roll is the hardest thing. And a lot of the time, I think Colin had asked questions about exit interviews. Certainly councillors I spoke to have left the roll. Remuneration, absolutely, but lack of value of the incredibly important job that you do is right up there.
Thank you for that. And you've touched upon my next question, but looking at the whole package, which would be recommended, I calculated around £5 million extra that would all be. And you've touched upon you believe the Scottish Government should help meet that cost. Is there any other options within councils, do you think, to help cover that cost? Or is this purely Scottish Government?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the responsibility would sit with Scottish Government. Like I say, we're facing some quite crucial cuts in some of our authorities at the moment. So really difficult to get the two things against one another. Stephen, I don't know if you want to add anything.
Yeah, thanks, Shona. I mean, responding to the initial question, the referring to 40% rise. Well, it's not a 40% rise. It's a autonomy calculator. I've been frantically churning the numbers, and it'd be for the regular councillor, it'd be about a 22% rise, which, you know, is still not insignificant. But I think it would recognise the fact that amongst our local government family, we are probably getting to the stage where we are the lowest paid employees in the building in many cases. But the regarding the cost, yes, we certainly don't want to be pitting the additional cost of an increase in councillor salary against the services that we provide. I think the report makes the fundamental point is there's a cost of democracy here that shouldn't be weighed against the provision of the services. So we'd definitely be looking for the Scottish Government to find the money to provide the 5 million that you refer to yourself. I think there's an additional point as well. I think it's an important recommendation around the severance arrangements, because it's been said by the SLAT members how the cliff edge is a very severe deterrent to seeking additional office a further term when the uncertainty is so great. And I think it would be an important step forward to, you know, provide the security to elected members who both lose office and who chose to leave office. Because I think it's important that we also have a a renewal of local government as well, and the, you know, more opportunities for new and enthusiastic members to come in, rather than weary old people like myself who will have been doing this job for 20 years by the end of this term. But, you know, I'm still open to the idea of doing it for 25, so I don't want to kind of suggest that the fire is dimming in anyone.
Thanks for that, Stephen. And it moves on to my next question. We previously heard SNARC's recommendations around the establishment of a dynamic national data set to actually look at the composition of our councils and councillors. And just wondered if COSLA had any specific views of why this has not been able to be made available to date and how we could create that. I know as a committee we've looked at this and some of the self-reporting has not then been available and some GDPR issues as well to look at councillors standing down. So just wondered if you had a view on that.
Yeah, it's certainly through our barriers group, we're absolutely identifying a need that we need to collate that data because absolutely it'll feed into all our recommendations coming out of that group. So still in the process of doing that piece of work and having those conversations, I think anecdotally it's been really helpful, like I say, visiting many of our colleagues around the country. We hear lots of very local issues that, you know, we can bring back to Scottish Government and have those discussions, and certainly previously when with the Minister for Local Government Empowerment, we did manage to have lots of those conversations and obviously reflected those in our discussions with the committee as well. So yeah, absolutely recognise a piece of work to do there, and working, you know, strongly with our third sector organisations as well, doing work with Lectar and Engender, and I believe officers had a meeting with the Boundary Commission as well recently to have, no, sorry, the Boundary, the Electoral Commission, to have some discussion around demographics of our councillors as well. So absolutely laser focus on that piece of work.
Yeah, thanks for that. And just finally, and we've discussed this previously, wondered if you could update the committee around the barriers to elected office special interest group, which COSLA have been doing, and when that's meant to report.
Thanks. So we're still, we've just actually increased the frequency of our meeting because we've got so much work to get through. So don't have any dates as of yet for reporting back, but it's been a hugely beneficial piece of work to do. We've got a great cross-representation that sit on the committee. You know, I think one session leads to even more questions and more kind of avenues for us to explore. So right now we're doing some work around proxy voting, which I mentioned previously, that's been seen as a fairly large issue for councillors, and certainly brought to us through colleagues in Aberdeen. They very much had a live case. So doing some work on that, obviously an eye to increasing BAME representation and women representation in our councils, and a lot of that includes the collecting the data around why women are leaving politics. You'll appreciate there's been some difficult discussions there, I think there's a huge amount of work for our political parties to do as well, to take responsibility for how we engage with our communities and make sure that, you know, our council chambers absolutely reflect the people we represent. It's not easy though.
Thanks.
But remuneration, sorry to interrupt you, Miles, but remuneration is always at the top of the list. It's the biggest barrier to everything.
Yep. Thanks, Camina.
Great. Thanks very much. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to all the COSLA officials, and thank you for your opening statements. SLARC state that there is a need to promote and work the work that councillors and councils do to improve awareness and understanding of the important role they play. Who's responsible for this promotion, and how does COSLA see its role in such promotion?
Thanks, morning, Pam. Nice to see you. I think we're all responsible, really. I think Scottish Government plays a role. I think all elected members, whether it's parliamentarians or ourselves, play a role in reminding the public the role of the council and the value of the councillor. So certainly our comms team is absolutely keen to demonstrate any good practice that we can see. So like I say, during these visits, we've managed to have some fantastic conversations around the country, around incredible innovation, transformation, all driven by our fantastic elected members. So very much use that platform that COSLA has to represent our councillors as best as we can. So a huge, obviously, continuing piece of work for us to make sure that the public realise what their councillors do on a day-to-day basis for them. But, you know, like I say, there's also a responsibility there for any elected member to talk about the virtues of the role of being a councillor and what we do. Stephen, I don't know if you want to come in.
Yeah, thanks very much. Absolutely, it's a costless role to promote local government and the work that we do, and indeed we do that on an ongoing basis. And you know, I would commend our elected members' bulletin to all members of the committee if you're not avidly reading it every week already. But I think Shona makes a good point that it's all our responsibilities, because I think you know, we're all constituent parts of the governance of the country, and it's important to demonstrate the mutual respect and positive working that goes on between the various spheres of government. I mean, this is underpinning absolutely where we went with the Verity House Agreement to develop a productive and positive relationship between the spheres of government, particularly local and national government. But I mean, in local government, obviously, we extend this to the work we do to support the work of the community councils and the work of our partners as well. So, you know, I think it would be indicative of a well-functioning democracy to be able to promote the work that we respectfully do. And this is obviously related to our aspirations around the European Charter of Local Self-Government, which sort of codifies some of this as well.
Thank you. Just turning the question on its head, do you believe that the public out there fully understand a councillor's role, but also the fact that they, you know, they don't get paid a certain amount of money and they're not full-time, but they are full-time in its own way as well? So do you think the public understand? I know that, Shona, you mentioned you can't even go to the shops. Obviously, I know how it feels, but obviously it's rewarding as well. It's nice for constituents to come up to you and speak to you as well. But do you think the public understand the councillor's remit and role, and also how they stretch to sometimes having their own job, but also having, you know, the council job as well?
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. It's a huge privilege to be a councillor, and we should remind ourselves of that all the time. I think people's experience would be mixed. I think if you're in contact with councillors and, you know, you've had experience of bringing issues to elected member, then your grasp and your understanding is obviously better of how sort of local democracy works. But I do remember years and years and years ago sitting and listening to John Curtis at a COSLA convention, a conference, beg your pardon, and talking about the spheres of government, the general public thing most influenced their life, and I was really disappointed to hear local government was quite far down it, considering the services that, you know, we provide and the decisions that are made by elected members. So there's never not work to do when it comes to promoting the role of councillors, and you know, we have those discussions within our local authorities and how best to do that piece of work, but certainly we have, you know, those conversations nationally as well. You know, we're always keen to work with our third sector partners, with any of our partners. So, you know, we've done a good piece of work with Police Scotland around councillor safety. So, and again, that's been within the public sphere as well, so that hopefully the public are able to see some of the issues that, some of the not so nice issues that we deal with daily and some of the abuse that we get. So, unfortunately, it's often those more negative stories that come into the public sphere, and we're always keen to try and turn that around and ensure sure that people see their councillors as a real positive addition and you know, local democracy working for them. Stephen, I don't know if you get anything.
Absolutely concur with what you're saying there, Shona. I mean, I think by and large, the public are appreciative of the role of the councillor and the difficulties that the councillors face. But there's no denying that there's very vocal and very visible minorities that they seek to lash out at the council because we are in the front line for service delivery. So, you know, any failings that are, you know, largely due to not having the resource to be able to provide the services that they would like to provide, the council is going to get it in the neck, and the councillors, as the visible representatives of the people, are going to be the people that get that. I think one of the interesting things to refer to here would be the annual household satisfaction survey, which kind of monitors the, or at least monitor. I'm not entirely sure that it still continues now that I think about it, but it recorded public satisfaction around the delivery of services. And that used to be very much a good news story when you received the report on that as a councillor, because it did show that the public in general were very satisfied with the services that were getting, and it kind of cut through the noise to a more realistic view of how the council is doing. I think it's undeniable that the public satisfaction is diminishing because they're seeing the visible effects of not being able to provide the services they would like, such as declining road quality, the inability to be able to provide support services in schools, and the difficulties we're facing in recruiting staff to work in care, particularly post-Brexit. So, you know, this is a kind of corrosive element to the functioning local government and the perception of local government and the how people view their councillors. But I mean, I think by and large, you know, there is a reasonable degree of understanding.
Thank you. Shona, you mentioned obviously women leaving and obviously having good BAME representation as well. So what evidence is there that pay is a significant barrier to candidates, particularly obviously women, people with disabilities, lone parents and young people?
Thanks, Pam. Can I just come back just on that last point as well? Just something to bring up around the recommendations around admin support. I think that's a really helpful one that the committee have made with regards to you know, the sort of day-to-day functions of councillors, and again, getting that story out there to the public about what we're doing. So whether that's through newsletters, etc., that office admin support would be absolutely crucial to really making sure that we're getting our stories out there. Sorry, but yeah, coming back to representation, remuneration in every sphere that we have these conversations with elected members or potential or people who have left councils, it always comes down to remuneration as the biggest barrier. Simple as that.
And Shona, why do you think that it's obviously particularly affecting women?
I think it's probably to do, so Angela mentioned earlier, with childcare. So again, back to accessing childcare for, you know, times of the day where perhaps you have got community meetings or you have, or council meetings, in fact. We've also got, you know, some councillors who live in rural areas where the transport's not so good. So again, maybe relying on taxis, quite expensive bus routes, etc. So all those sorts of things people have to take into consideration. The outlay, you know, albeit they can claim and travel expenses, but you'll appreciate that, unfortunately, councillors don't like to document all of the expenses that they have, because some feel it is part of the job, and again, that can be a massive barrier for many people standing, that they don't perhaps want to, because this is published, and they perhaps don't want to have that within the public realm that they are claiming for the expenses, so that'll come out of their own pocket. So there's issues like that we've picked up in the various forums where we've had these discussions.
And just lastly, Shona, is there anything, obviously pay is very important, how much salary the councillors get, and rightfully deserve as well. Now, do you think there's anything else that needs changing there, a bit of transformational change, that how councillors work maybe? Because you did mention childcare. And is there anything in the pipeline that COSLAR are working on with local authorities in relation to how working patterns or even easy access and things? Are you working on anything like that?
I think absolutely. When it comes to transformation, I suppose one of the biggest things most recently has been that shift onto online working, and that absolutely reduces barrier for many people. Unfortunately, you kind of see a fall back into patterns of expectations to meet in person, and that's quite disappointing, especially when few people feel like you often don't get the full kind of benefit of the meeting unless you're there in person. So we're keen to continue to support our elected members with that. Issues around council safety as well. I think I've mentioned the work we've done with Police Scotland, incredibly important to ensure that our councillors feel as safe as possible in their working environments. And again, political discourse, lots of women especially experience very, very negative comments within social media. So again, it's just to ensure that we're protecting our councillors as much as possible, and work that we're doing in barriers to elected office absolutely targets that. But I think, as a whole, as all elected members, we have a responsibility to ensure that we protect councillors as much as possible from that sort of negative discourse.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thanks.
I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey with a brief supplementary.
Thank you very much, convener. Shona, it was just on that point there that Pam raised. What's causing the drift back from online and all that digital participation back to the in-person attendance? Is it the political party groupings themselves, or is it the officials? Because that was one of the few benefits that saved us during COVID, the digital participation that was widespread throughout workplaces in Scotland and everywhere else for that part. So what's your impression that why that drift back? Who's causing that drift back to in-person?
I'm not entirely sure whether it's people are just more comfortable. Possibly the demographic that we see spread across Scotland when it comes to elected members, that perhaps in person is what people feel more comfortable with. Certainly at COSLAR, we're very, very keen to obviously give the option of online at all times. And we do find that the majority of our leaders attend online these days. And that's absolutely fine. And that's cross-party. I wouldn't say that that's defined through party at all. You often find that our members who have further to travel are actually the ones who come in person. And I think that's a very personal choice, and I think that's to be applauded in many circumstances, because it will be our elected members from our islands who are often independent councillors, and they find real value, obviously, in being in the room with one another. And we absolutely shouldn't, put any barriers in their way for making that happen. So I'm not entirely sure, and I find it slightly disappointing. Certainly within my own authority, I'm seeing that drift back to in-person. And as having to make a special request to be online, like I say, it's certainly for those councillors who have other responsibilities, whether it's caring or other jobs as well, or cost implications at travel, etc. It absolutely is such a hugely beneficial route to be able to utilise.
Okay, thanks for that, Shona. Thank you. Thanks,
Stephen. I don't know if you get anything else.
I'm going to. Stephen,
Do you have
got anything else to add?
Yeah, I was just going to add that in some cases there's a desire to go back to the in-person meetings just for the human interaction and just getting to know your colleagues as people. In COSLAR's context, we seek to try and have one meeting in three. We try and encourage people to come along to the meetings in person, just to kind of facilitate the both cross-party dialogue, but also just so that the councillors from the various
disparate geographic areas of Scotland have a chance to see what it's like in the other areas. I mean, we have the great fortune that we're going to every council area in Scotland and speaking to the councillors directly, so we have a good overview. But I think in doing so, we recognise that it's a benefit to everybody to know how everybody else works.
Important to keep that hybrid option, and I think that's a good approach of encouraging a meeting where you could imagine seeing most of the people on your committee or whatever. I'm going to bring in Gordon MacDonald, who's joining us online. He's got a couple of questions.
Thanks, thanks very much, Convener. A couple of points that's not been touched on in the area. Recommendation 15 talks about strengthening requirements on councillors to perform their duties. Now, obviously, we've touched upon the fact that there's very little support in some councils for elected members, particularly opposition elected members. And I'm just wondering if you've got a view about what the minimum level of member support services should be and what it should include.
Thanks, Gord. Nice to see you. Hi. It's difficult to say because each council is so incredibly different. Some operate, as you'll appreciate, cabinets. Some have, that traditional committee structure. I'll take my own example. We've got one admin support who is PA to the council leader and to the civic lead as well, and covers off every other need and requirement from all 26 councillors. So you'll appreciate the huge demand that puts on that person, and that's an area that we've seen, you know, reduced over the years, and I'm sure that's the story in many, many other councils around Scotland. So absolutely an investment would be most appreciated in that area, because, you know, rather than put sort of onerous tasks on admin, we tend to just pick those things up ourselves, and it does absolutely take time away from that sort of face-to-face contact we have with our constituents, or, you know, other demands, whether it's kind of research into whatever committee we're on, etc. So, hugely appreciative of that recommendation. If we can support invest within admin support, I think we would see, massive improvements, certainly in the area that I spoke about, around making us visible, getting our story across, etc. And supporting, you know, new counselors into the role, they play a massive role in that as well. I would have been completely lost if it hadn't been for admin support. So, that investment would be greatly welcomed and part of that sort of early days of being a new counselor as well. Stephen, I don't know if you want to.
Yeah, thanks very much. I wonder if we've lost the committee here. Gordon, in response to your question around the recommendation, the COSLA supports the SLAT report in its entirety, but absolutely around this recommendation, there was a degree of concern expressed by some leaders as to, you know, there's no parallel in such reporting for MSPs. And it's not really the council's job to be the policeman in this, and that there is perhaps a risk that the Scottish Government might interfere in the appointment or the sustained appointment of councillors, who have been democratically elected, and, you know, fundamentally the big job interview comes every 5 years and you get your performance appraisal there. I think as COSLA, we endorse the recommendation because we don't think there's anything to hide. But there's not really evidence of this being a big problem, and that the already many councils do such performance reporting, in the sense that they report attendance at meetings alongside the annual expenses, which has to be reported for the press. And which is going through that cycle now in my own council, and, you know, the attendances are universally high. So, there's Whether there's a need for it, it remains to be seen, but the recommendation is that it's considered, so we're happy with it at that level.
Gordon, do you want to pick up your other questions? And Stephen, I want to assure you, maybe you can't see us, but we are definitely here listening very keenly.
Yeah, Stephen, my point about raising the question was that if there was to be strengthening of requirements on councillors' duties, then it has to go hand in hand with more support. But the other question I was going to ask you was about training. Is there enough training for new councillors and ongoing training, in particular dealing with the media, dealing how to handle surgeries, how to make speeches in the chamber and cross-examine council officials? I mean, is there enough training? Because a lot of people who might consider wanting to be a councillor won't have a lot of experience in those areas.
Hey, can I come in since...
yeah, you can come in first, Stephen, yeah.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, I mean, I think it's a very good point. And if I was going to be frank, I think the answer to your question is probably no, not yet, because the training in the kind of areas that you suggest I wouldn't say it's probably widely available. I mean, certainly the recommendations in the report, I think recommendations 17 and 19 kind of go into this to a certain extent and suggest that we should be looking for the areas that could be supported more and develop that. You know, I would regard that as a positive development. Certainly, most councils will have very good induction processes for new councillors that explain the kind of legislative requirements on councillors, the kind of the governance frameworks that they're operating in terms of the standing orders and the scheme of delegation and things like that, and indeed the committee structure and the organisational structure of the council. And, you know, the induction process for that can be fairly intense over maybe 3 weeks. But the kind of things like the chairing skills and media responsibilities, I think that's probably quite far down the list compared with the getting on board with the kind of the day-to-day business. And I think it's a fair point that you make that it would be useful to explore that more. And alongside what Shona was saying around the kind of the general support for councillors, how that could be enhanced administratively. I think Shona's wanting to come in.
Yeah, sorry, to come out to get off mute there. So, yeah, no, absolutely concur with all Stephen's points, Gordon. I would say, though, that the Improvement Service does a huge amount of work when it comes to some of those sort of induction processes, and certainly that's been increasing over the years. So, but again, it depends council to council about how much, you know, what the uptake looks like. And certainly that's a job of work for the Improvement Service to get that message out there. COSLA is doing regular thematic sessions as well online to try and engage councillors around all sorts of issues that may be of interest. But absolutely agree with Stephen around the media training and speech making. We kind of fall away a bit. Certainly my own council does a lot of training when it comes to scrutiny, what good scrutiny looks like, what notice of motion, things like that. But when it comes to the likes of speeches, media training, we do fall down. And I suppose there's a reliance, and I appreciate we've got lots of independent councillors, but we do have a reliance, or we believe there may be a reliance on political parties also to ready their candidates for those types of responsibilities, but that shouldn't be the case. I do agree that we it's absolutely upon us to ensure that councillors are comfortable and ready to enter the chambers.
I think Gordon, you were just saying concluding there. Is that you were?
Yep.
Your mic wasn't on. Okay, super. Thanks very much, Stephen. Okay, well, we've come to our end of our questions. I think it's been very helpful to hear from you and your reflections on SLARC's work and their report. And so thanks so much for joining us today. And I will, as that's the final public item on our agenda today, I now close the public part of our meeting.